بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ولي الصالحين، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله، الداعي إلى صراط مستقيم، صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن سار على نهجه واقتفى أثره يوم الدين، أما بعد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن هذا القرآن يهدي للتي هي أقوم ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا كبيرا، وأن الذين لا يؤمنون بالآخرة أعتدنا لهم عذابا أليما. ويدعو الإنسان بالشر دعاءه بالخير، وكان الإنسان عجولا، وجعلنا الليل والنهار آيتين، فمحونا آية الليل وجعلنا آية النهار مبصرة لتبتغوا فضلا من ربكم ولتعلموا عدد السنين والحساب، وكل شيء فصلناه تفصيلا. وكل إنسان ألزمناه طائره في عنقه، ونخرج له يوم القيامة كتابا يلقاه منشورا. اقرأ كتابك كفى بنفسك اليوم عليك حسيبا. من اهتدى فإنما يهتدي لنفسه، ومن ضل فإنما يضل عليها، ولا تزر وازرة وزر أخرى، وما كنا معذبين حتى نبعث رسولا. وإذا أردنا أن نهلك قرية أمرنا متر فيها ففسقوا فيها فحق عليها القول فدمرناها تدميرا. وكم أهلكنا من القرون من بعد نوح، وكم أهلكنا من القرون من بعد نوح، وكفى بربك بذنوب عباده خبيرا بصيرا.
After praising Allah جل في علاه and sending salutations upon the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, we proceed. And alhamdulillah that Allah Azza wa Jalla has gathered us here this evening. And I ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make this a blessed gathering. And I ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make us from those who are forgiven this gathering. And I ask Allah Azza wa Jalla that He makes us from those who hear this speech and follow the best of it. And I ask Allah Jalla fi ulah, just like He gathered us here this evening, that He gathers us in Jannat al-Firdaws al-A'la with our parents and our loved ones and all those who have rights upon us. إِنَّهُ لِذَلِكَ وَالْقَادْرُ عَلَيْهِ أَيُّهَا الْإِخْوَةُ وَالْأَخَوَاتُ. First of all, I'm extremely glad to be here, to see all your beautiful, wonderful faces here this evening, coming to the house of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, seeking the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal. And this is one of the greatest acts that one can engage in. Coming to the house of Allah and seeking that which benefits him, knowledge that will benefit him in this world and the hereafter. That which will get him closer to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. It's a great blessing that we must be those who are grateful to Allah Jalla fi'ula for. And Allah Azza wa Jal, He tells us in the Quran that when we are grateful to Him for the blessings that He grants us, and the greatest blessing that Allah has granted us is the blessing of Al-Islam and being able to worship Allah and know our Creator. When we are grateful to Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah will increase us in that blessing. How do we show gratitude to Allah? And how do we be those who are thankful to Allah Azza wa Jal? By increasing our worship. Worship is how we show gratitude to Allah Azza wa Jal. وَإِذْ تَأَذَّنَ رَبُّكُمْ لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ وَلَإِنْ كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. When your Lord proclaimed, if you are grateful, I shall increase you in the blessing, Allah says. Allah will increase you in the blessing of guidance, being able to worship Him. Allah will increase in the blessing of goodness. Allah reserve the blessings that you have for you. But if you're ungrateful, then know that my punishment, it is severe. The houses of Allah, the masajid, they are gardens of paradise, as the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he described them. And these are gatherings that whoever attends them, they don't leave empty-handed. They go away with something. Even the one who didn't come here for the purpose of attending the gathering of knowledge, he still leaves with the reward of forgiveness and mercy and Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala praising in the heavens and so on. But ayyuhal kiram, Allah Azza wa Jal, He granted us the greatest blessing, one of the greatest blessings that we have, which is the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, the Quran. And Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us this Quran, it's been granted to us as a mercy from Allah Azza wa Jalla. He Jalla wa Ala, He says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ar Rahman. Allama al Quran, khalaqa al insana, allamahu al bayan. Ar-Rahman, the most merciful. Allah mentions His mercy. And then straight after mentioning His mercy, He mentions that He taught the Quran. That indicates to us that Allah being granting you the ability to learn the Quran and having the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla amongst us and be amongst those who learn the Quran, memorize the Quran, listen to the Quran, recite the Quran and live by the Quran. That's a mercy from Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. علم القرآن. From the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal is that He taught us the Quran. We must be amongst those who rush towards that mercy of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, to attain that mercy through the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, by learning the Quran, by being amongst those who implement the Quran, who live their lives in accordance to the Quran. Because Allah Azza wa Jal revealed the Quran as a methodology of life. We're meant to live by it. It is guidance for all of mankind. Allah Azza wa Jal says, هدى للناس. The Quran is guidance for all of mankind. But there's a specific key. If you have that key, you shall be able to unlock the guidance of the Quran, where Allah Azza wa Jalla tells in the Quran what it is. He says, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. This is the book, the Quran. There's no doubt in it. It is guidance for the muttaqeen, those who are conscious of Allah, those who fear Allah, those who worship Allah Azza wa Jalla with that fear in their heart, that taqwa is that consciousness, that fear in your heart that prevents you from doing that which angers Allah, that prevents you from doing that which Allah Azza wa Jalla prohibited. It creates a shield between you and that which angers Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. That is taqwa. Those individuals who have that taqwa, that consciousness, that will enable them to unlock the guidance of the Quran further. This book, the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jalla, He tells us and He describes it in the Quran. Let's hear what the Quran has to say about the Quran. Allah says,
يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِّنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ وَهُدًى وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ.
O mankind, an admonishment has come to you from your Lord, the Quran. And a cure for what's in the chests, the hearts. وَهُدًا and its guidance. وَرَحْمَةً and mercy for the believers.
قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ,
say with the bounties of Allah.
وَرَحْمَتِهِ
and His mercy. With that they shall rejoice. That's better than everything else that they accumulate and gather. That's the Qur'an. The Qur'an is a cure for all the struggles that you're struggling with. All the illness of the heart, the lack of sincerity, the illnesses of the heart, the envy, the hatred, the jealousy, the arrogance, that pride that you have in your heart, all these illnesses that cause the heart to die, the Quran is a cure for that. It's a cure for the sins that you're struggling with. It's a cure for the physical illnesses.
وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ ما هو شفاء ورحمة للمؤمنين وننزل من القرآن ما هو شفاء ورحمة للمؤمنين ولا يزيد الظالمين إلا خسارا.
We remove from the Qur'an that which is a cure and a mercy for the believers. That cure. Every time I recite the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, every time I listen to the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, the Qur'an, I should listen with the intention that I'm seeking that cure from Allah Azza wa Jal for all the illnesses that I'm suffering from. Because we're not only talking about physical illness. You may say to yourself, I'm physically healthy, but is your heart healthy? Is your soul healthy? When you're reciting the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, recite it with the intention that it cures the illnesses of the soul and your heart, so that your heart becomes a healthy heart that's attached to Allah, that's a sound heart. There was a man amongst the Tabi'een, his name was Maymun ibn Mahran, rahimahullah azza wa jalla. Maymun, from the ulama of the Tabi'een. Maymun rahmatullahi alayhi, one day he was with his son, and he said to his son that, I feel like my heart, it is dying or it's dead, it's become extremely hard. Let's go to Al-Hasan al-Basri, so that he can remind me of Allah Azza wa Jalla to soften my heart. Look at how these people were. They were those who were conscious of their heart. They were conscious of the health of their heart. They didn't go on with life as if nothing has happened, heedless. No. They were conscious of their hearts and they did something about it and they knew what the solution was. The remembrance of Allah Azza wa Jalla, that is what remedies the hearts. That's what revives it. So he went to Al-Hasan al-Basri. They went to his house. And he said to him, Ya Aba Sa'id, I feel like my heart is dying. Remind me of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala so that that can revive my heart and remedy my heart and cure my heart. So Al-Hasan al-Basri rahmatullahi alayhi, he He reminded him with the greatest form of remembrance, Kalamullah, the speech of Allah Azza wa Jal. He recited ayat in Surah Shu'ara, where Allah Azza wa Jal says,
أَفَرَأَيْتَ إِن مَتَّعْنَاهُمْ سِنِينَ ثُمَّ جَاءَهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يُوعَدُونَ مَا أَغْنَى عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يُمَتَّعُونَ وَمَا أَهْلَكْنَا مِنْ قَرْيَةٍ إِلَّا لَهَا مُنذِرُونَ ذِكْرًا وَمَا كُنَّا ظَالِمِينَ وَمَا تَنَزَّلَتْ بِهِ الشَّيَاطِينَ وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُمْ وَمَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ إنهم عن السمع لمعزولون فلا تدع مع الله إلها آخر فتكون من المعذبين.
He recited these ayats from Surah Shu'ara, where Allah Azza wa Jalla says, أَفَرَأَيْتَ إِن مَتَّعْنَاهُمْ سِنِينَ. Have you seen when we allowed them to live for years in enjoyment? I.e. the disbelievers. They lived in this dunya for years, enjoying their lives. ثُمَّ جَاءَهُمْ. And then came to them that which they were promised, i.e. death and the day of judgment. And then that which they enjoyed in this world did not benefit them, did not protect them from the punishment of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Al-Hassan al-Basri, when he recited these ayat, Maymun ibn Mahran, his heart was struck by these verses. He felt unconscious and his son tried to wake him up. Ya Abati, wake up. He wouldn't wake up. He shook him. He wouldn't wake up. And he shook him again. He wouldn't wake up until they poured cold water on him. And then he got up and it looked like the soul had been taken out of him.
Why? Because the Quran had affected his heart. It struck his heart. That's because they understood the speech of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, and due to them understanding the Quran, it affected them immediately. Because the Quran affects you even when you don't understand it. What about when you understand it? Imagine how great the effect is. The disbelievers who didn't believe in the Quran, who didn't follow the Quran, because they understood the Quran, when they heard it, they were affected by it. It overpowered them to the extent that it made them prostrate in Mecca. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, when he was in Mecca, they recited Surah Al-Najm, and then he recited in front of the disbelievers of Quraysh, and they're hearing the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام recite it, and as he's reciting it, he gets towards the end of the surah.
هذا نذير من النذر الأولى أزفت الآزفة ليس لها من دون الله كاشفة أفمن هذا الحديث تعجبون وتضحكون ولا تبكون وأنتم سامدون فاسجدوا لله واعبدوا.
He got to the last ayah. فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ وَاعْبُدُوا. Prostrate to Allah and worship Him. And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام prostrated because his ayah of sujood. And the Sahaba رضي الله عنه prostrated. And all of Kuffar Quraysh prostrated. Why? That's the power of the Quran. It overpowered their limbs. The hearts and the limbs are overpowered by the Quran because the Quran is revealed upon the hearts of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, and it addresses the hearts. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He tells us that specifically in the Quran.
وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينُ عَلَى قلبك لتكون من المنذرين بلسان عربي مبين.
Allah says, verily, this revelation, the Quran, is from the Lord of the universe, Allah. Came down with it, Jibreel alayhi salam, the trustworthy, upon your heart, O Muhammad alayhi salatu salam, so that you are amongst the warners with the Arabic tongue, the Arabic language. This Quran, Allah tells us that there are three matters that if we use these three matters effectively, the Quran will benefit from it.
إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَذِكْرَى لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ أَوْ أَلْقَى السَّمْعَ وَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ.
Allah says verily in that is a reminder, a lesson in the Quran and the verse of the Quran for the one who possesses a heart that's alive, a heart that believes in Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, a heart that's protected from the illness of the heart, a pure sound heart, and one who listens attentively when the Quran is being recited. He listens attentively when the Quran is being recited to him, when he's reading the Quran, when he's reciting the Quran, he is paying attention. وَهُوَ shaheed, whilst he's present, he's not absent-minded. When the Quran is being recited, when he's reading the Quran, they're not absent-minded. His mind and heart are present. If he does that, they will benefit from the Quran. As Ibn Qayyim alayhi rahmatullah, he says that in order for one to benefit from the Quran, he requires these three matters. They are the pillars of benefiting from the Quran. This Quran, imagine a man who does not understand the language of the Quran. He does not understand the Arabic language. When the Quran was recited to him, imagine what happened to him. When the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they migrated to Abyssinia, they came to this part of the world, East Africa. And they met the king, An-Najashi. When they met An-Najashi, what happened? They had a discussion about the reason why they left the Arabian Peninsula, that they were being persecuted by their people because their faith, what Islam is all about. And then eventually later on, Ja'far radiallahu anhu, he recites the Quran to An-Najashi. He recites Surah Maryam to him. Now Najashi is speaking to Ja'far through an interpreter. He doesn't speak Arabic. Najashi hears these ayat about Maryam alayhi salam and Isa alayhi salam. He's a Christian. And it's being translated to him eventually. But he hears it in Arabic initially before it's translated. And then what happens? He starts to weep. He starts to cry until his beard became moist. Ajib. He doesn't understand the language of the Quran. But the Quran affected him like that. Now the question that stands is, imagine if we all understood the Quran in this language, how the Quran would actually transform our lives. It changed individuals who were criminals from the greatest criminals. They heard verses from the Quran, their lives changed 100%. Imagine a man came to Medina with ill intent to harm the Prophet alayhi salatu. He wants to get revenge after the Battle of Badr because he had relatives and friends and so on who were killed in the Battle of Badr. He's a disbeliever. He comes at a time where the Prophet alayhi salatu was reciting Quran in Salat al-Maghrib. So he hears the Quran. The Prophet alayhi salatu starts to recite Surah Al-Tur. And it gets to the ayat,
أَمْ تَأْمُرُهُمْ أَحْلَامُهُمْ بِهَذَا أَمْ هُمْ قَوْمٌ طَاغُونَ أَمْ يَقُولُونَ تَقَوَّلَهُ بَلْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ فَلْيَأْتُوا بِحَدِيثٍ أم خلقوا من غير شيء أم هم الخالقون أم خلقوا السماوات والأرض بل لا يوقنون أم عندهم خزائن ربك أم هم المسيطرون أم لهم سلم يستمعون فيه فليأت مستمعهم بسلطان مبين.
He had these verses where the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام recited the ayat that Allah says, were they created from nothing? Who are they, the creators? Or did they create the heavens and the earth? Rather, they are not certain. When he heard these ayat, this man, Jubayr ibn Mut'im, that was his name, he says, he's a disbeliever, he says, هذا قلبي أن يطير, my heart almost flew out of my chest because of how much the verses affected him, and that led to him embracing Islam. Imagine, he came with the intention to harm the Muslims, and he left loving Islam, and loving the Quran, and loving the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. That's the effect of the Quran. Now the question that every single one of us needs to ask himself, it is that I'm a Muslim, perhaps my whole life, perhaps I memorized the whole Quran, perhaps I've been reciting the Quran my whole life, perhaps I've completed the Quran, many recitations of the book of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, many khatamat. The question that I need to ask myself, it is, how has the Quran affected my life? What change have I seen in my life every time I recite the book of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala? Do I recite the Quran as if it's just a book that should be recited with no effect? Or do I recite it with the intention that this Quran is going to make me better, is going to draw me closer to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and I'm going to be amongst the people of the Quran? Ibn Qayyim rahmatullahi alayhi says who the people of the Quran are. He says, أهل القرآن هم العاملون به ولو لم يحفظوه. The people of the Quran, the elite people of Allah Azza wa Jal, who are they? They are those who act upon the Quran. What defines the people of the Quran is their implementation of the Quran. He said they are those who act upon the Quran even if they did not manage to memorize the Quran. If they found it difficult to memorize the Quran, they didn't have the ability to memorize the Quran, they didn't have the opportunity to memorize the Quran, but they lived by the Quran and they act upon the Quran, they can be from Ahlul Quran. They are those who act upon the Quran even if they did not manage to memorize it. That should be the goal of every single one of us. This is the book that Allah revealed to us. We are the people of this book. But in order to be the people of this book truly, we have to be followers of this Quran. We have to be those who live by this Quran. We have to be those who call others to the Quran. We teach the Quran. The Quran should be evident in your speech and actions. It should be evident in your conduct. It should be evident in everything you do. That before you take a step, before you do anything, you ask yourself, what does the Quran say about this? Before you intend to even do anything, you ask yourself, what does the Quran say about this? Nowadays, we become the opposite. We are those, we become those, we do things, and then we ask after, what does Islam say about this? La. So you're doing it the wrong way around. We are doing it the wrong way. The way that we have been taught to do it, that we have to be those who do not proceed with Allah and His Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam have told us. Allah tells us that's a sign of your iman, your faith.
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ.
Oh, you believe, those who have faith and iman, do not precede Allah and the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam with any speech, with any actions. You first find out, what does Allah say about this? What does the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam say about this? And then you proceed to do something. You don't do something, and then later on look at what Allah and the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam say about this. That is not the attitude of the believer. That's not the way the believer behaves. Because the believer, the Muslim, is the one who fully surrenders to the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. He fully commits himself to the path of Allah Azza wa Jal. That is what Islam means. Al-Istislam, to surrender, to submit.
يا أيها الذين آمنوا
يا أيها الذين آمنوا ادخلوا في السلم كافة. Oh, you who believe, enter Islam completely, wholly. Don't pick and choose what you like, you accept it fully. That's what it means to be a slave of Allah Azza wa Jal. وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It's not for the believing man and the believing woman. When Allah and His Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام command a matter, that they have any choice in the matter. Rather, their response is, we hear and we obey. That's the believer. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they were those who did that immediately, instantly. Whenever they heard a command from the Allah and the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, they implemented it immediately without hesitation, without any reluctance. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, one day, he saw a companion who was wearing a golden ring. Wearing golden ring is haram for men. The Prophet ﷺ, he told him to take it off because it's prohibited. And the Prophet ﷺ took the ring and he threw it on the floor. That man, he was about to walk away from that ring. There was a companion that came up to him and he said to him, why don't you pick up the ring and at least benefit from it, sell it, make some money out of it. He said, I'm never going to pick up something the Prophet ﷺ threw away. Instant submission. No ifs, no buts. One day the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they were praying behind the Prophet alayhi salatu in prayer. As they were praying, they were outside, they were wearing their shoes, they were praying outside. During the prayer, the Prophet alayhi salatu took off his shoes. When he took off his shoes, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they noticed that and they all removed their shoes during the prayer. Then after the prayer, the Prophet alayhi salatu noticed that they all took off their shoes in the prayer. So we asked them, why did you take off your shoes? They said, Ya Rasulullah, we saw you do that, so we did it. They didn't need a reason. Just merely seeing the Prophet ﷺ do that, that was sufficient for them. Then the Prophet ﷺ told him the reason. He said, the reason why I took off my shoes, it is because Jibreel ﷺ came to me during the prayer and informed me that my shoes, they had some najasa on it, some filth. So I removed it. But they imitate the Prophet ﷺ in everything. That's a sahaba. That's what made them the best people after the prophets and the messengers. Because of their full submission to the religion of Allah Azza wa Jal. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, he says, when the ayah of prohibition of alcohol was revealed, he said, I was pouring some wine for some of the companions. And then we were informed whilst we were drinking that alcohol and I was pouring for some of them that the ayah has been revealed. He says that all of the streets of Medina were filled with alcohol. Everyone poured it out. And he looked at this, look how far the Sahaba they went. He says that some of the Sahaba, those who drank the wine prior to knowing it was haram, they made themselves vomit it out. They're not required to do so, but they made themselves vomit it out because that's how much they implemented the command of Allah Azza wa Jal. Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha, al-mu'mineen, she says when the ayah of hijab was revealed, she says that the women, the Ansar, they were informed about this and they found out that the ayah of hijab, the women have to cover up now. She said the women of Ansar, they came out of their homes, they were covered up so much to the extent that they looked like walking tents. Nobody said, one last day, I'm not ready yet. La. Instantly, immediately implementing the command of Allah and the command of the Prophet ﷺ. By doing so, that's what makes you from Ahlul Quran. Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu anhu arda'ah, that great man, that powerful man, that brave, courageous man, when he would hear the Quran, he would weep, he would cry. He had two black marks on his cheeks because of how much he cried because of the Quran. Umar radiallahu anhu, when he was Khalifa, he made all his advisors, his ministers, from the people of the Quran, so they could advise him with the Quran. And he was known as Waqaf inda Kitabillah, one who would immediately stop when it seemed like what he was doing was in contradiction to the Quran. One day, a man, a Bedouin, came to Umar radiallahu anhu,
and he came to request something from Umar. But he did it in a very rude manner. And Umar radiallahu anhu, he was one who did not tolerate nonsense. The moment he heard this man address him in that manner, in that rude manner, who was asking for something that is not his right, Umar radiallahu anhu grabbed a stick and he was going to send that man to the Akhirah. It turns out that the nephew of Umar was one of the advisors. The nephew of that man, sorry, was one of the advisors of Umar. So this nephew, he doesn't want his uncle to be beaten up. He wants to save him. What does he do? He says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says, خُضِ الْعَفْوَ وَأْمُرُ بِالْعُرْفِ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ. Allah says, pardon and enjoy good and turn away from the ignorant. Verily this man, i.e. his uncle, he's from the ignorant. Umar radiallahu anhu, he immediately stopped. How many of us can actually do that when they get angry? How many of us can actually stop themselves when they're in a state of anger, when they're reminded of Allah and the speech of Allah? Almost impossible for the majority of us. Some of us, when we tell them, say, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan rajim, he will say, you are the shaytan, go away. He will not calm down. He will carry on and fulfill whatever he wants to do in that moment of anger. But those Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they were those that no matter what they're feeling, the emotions, Allah and what the Prophet said came before their emotions, their opinions, and so on. And they acted by that, they lived by that. He stopped immediately, Umar radiallahu anhum. And there's many occasions in his life where he did the same thing. That's why he was given that title, one who would immediately stop if he was reminded the speech of Allah Azza wa Jal. Ayyuha al-Kiram, the Quran, this book that Allah has granted us, our obligation towards the Quran, it is that every single one of us needs to make the effort to learn the Quran. That's the least that you can do. What does it mean to learn the Qur'an? Learning the Qur'an is a journey of a lifetime. It does not end with just memorizing the Qur'an like a lot of people think. Yes, memorizing the Qur'an is great and it's virtuous and it's rewarding and it's extremely highly recommended. But that's not where it stops. Memorizing the Qur'an is merely the first step. We must, after we memorize the Qur'an, we must learn what the Qur'an means. Understand it in depth so that we can reflect upon the Quran and live with the Quran. Wallahi, the life with the Quran, al-aishu ma'al Quran, the life with the Quran, it's an incredible life that only one who's tasted it and experienced it knows what it's like. We can't even describe it. The contentment and happiness and joy you feel when you live your life with the Quran. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed this Quran as a source of happiness and contentment. Allah says, مَا أَنزِلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لِيَتَشْقَى. We have not revealed the Qur'an to you as a source of grief and sorrow and sadness. Rather, it's a source of happiness and contentment. That Qur'an, Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us that in order for us to attain that guidance of the Qur'an, we must understand it, reflect upon it, delve into the deep meanings of the Qur'an. It's an ocean that has no coast. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alif Lam Ra. Kitabun anzalnahu ilayka litukhrijan nasa minal dhulumati ilan nur. لتخرج الناس من الظلمات إلى النور بإذن ربهم إلى صراط العزيز الحميد. Allah tells us this Quran is a book that we revealed to you, O Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام, to take the people out of the darknesses of misguidance to the light of guidance with the permission of their Lord to the straight path of Allah Azza wa Jal. That's the objective the Qur'an is revealed by for. But in order for you to be guided by the Qur'an and to attain that guidance of the Qur'an, you must make an effort to understand the Quran. Because the Quran, by you learning it and understanding it and living with the Quran, it is the greatest matter that will help you stay steadfast upon the religion of Allah Azza wa Jal. Keep you firm and steadfast upon the religion of Allah. The stronger relationship with the Quran is, the more likely Allah Azza wa Jal will make you steadfast upon His religion. Because Allah says in the Quran,
قُلْ نَزَّلَهُ رُوحُ الْقُدُسِ مِنْ رَبِّكَ بِالْحَقُّ لِيُثَبِّتَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَهُدًى وَبُشْرَى لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ.
Saying, O Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, came down with this Quran, is Jibreel alayhi salam, from your Lord, with the truth, to make firm and steadfast those who believe. And is guidance and guidance for the Muslims. The Quran is that which is going to increase you in that guidance that you are seeking. Keep you steadfast upon it. Keep you firm upon it until you meet Allah Azza wa Jal. That's why it is essential for us to strengthen our bond with the Book of Allah Azza wa Jal. It's what helps you maintain your iman and keep your iman up and increases your iman. Because Allah Azza wa Jal, He specified the Quran when He spoke about iman increasing in the Quran. Allah says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهِ
وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وعلى ربهم يتوكلون.
The believers are those, when Allah is mentioned, their hearts tremble, their hearts are affected. And when the verses of the Quran, the verses of Allah are recited to them, that increases them in iman, that increases them in faith. Allah specified the Quran. Because generally righteous deeds and acts of obedience, they increase our faith. But the Quran is one of the greatest ways that one increases their iman and helps you stay away from that which angers Allah Azza wa Jal. It's impossible for one who spends his day and spends the majority of his day reciting the Book of Allah, listening to the Book of Allah, learning the Book of Allah, understanding the Book of Allah, teaching the Book of Allah, living his life with the Quran, it's almost impossible for him to disobey Allah Azza wa Jal. Because the Quran will serve as a shield that protects you from that which angers Allah Azza wa Jal. It's almost impossible, you feel guilty, how can you do something haram when you're with the Quran? Right? That's the Book of Allah Azza wa Jal. So I want every single one of us, me included, that we make that firm intention that I'm going to rectify my relationship with the Quran. I'm going to make that firm intention right now. Make that promise to Allah Azza wa Jal right now that I'm going to take that step towards the Book of Allah Azza wa Jal. I'm going to make my relationship with the Quran better. I'm going to make an effort to learn the Quran. I'm going to make an effort to recite the Quran every single day, a portion of the Quran. I'm going to make an effort to listen to a portion of the Quran every single day. I'm going to make an effort to understand what the Quran means. I'm going to at least attend a tafsir class in my local masjid so that I understand what the Quran means and I can connect to the speech of Allah Azza wa Jal better. By doing so, inshallah Azza wa Jal, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will make your life a life of bliss and blessings and happiness and contentment and goodness until you meet Allah Azza wa Jal. Are we all ready for that? Huh? Everyone's ready? You're making that promise with Allah Azza wa Jal. Raise your hand if you're ready. Huh? Raise your hand. Every single one of us have now raised our hands. We made that promise with Allah, not with Yahya. With Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah sees us. And inshallah tabarak wa ta'ala, we are going to fulfill that with Allah Azza wa Jal. I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to make us from the people of the Quran. I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to make us from those who live by the Quran. I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to forgive our sins. I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to have mercy upon us. I ask Allah jalla fi'ala to make us all from His righteous servants. I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to make us from those who is said to read and rise and ascend and recite like you used to recite in dunya, and your position in Jannah will be by the last verse that you recite. I ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to make us from the people of the Quran, the elite people of Allah Azza wa Jal. I ask Allah Jalla fi Ula to make the Quran an intercessor for us yawm al-qiyamah. I ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to make the Quran an evidence for us yawm al-qiyamah, not against us. I ask Allah Azza wa Jal to guide us and to increase us in guidance and to guide others through us. I ask Allah Jalla fi Ula to grant us taqwa and to accept our deeds and to grant us sincerity in our statements and actions. I ask Allah Jalla fi Ula to forgive us and our parents and to have mercy upon us and our parents and to make us from those who are dutiful to their parents. And I ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to grant us beneficial knowledge. And I ask Allah Jalla fi Ula to make us from those who hear this speech and follow the best of it. And I ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to grant us His pleasure and to be pleased with us. And I ask Allah Jalla fi Ula to protect us from all fitan, ma zahara minha wa ma batan, the hidden ones and the apparent ones. And I ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to purify our hearts and to rectify our hearts and to attach our hearts to Allah Azza wa Jalla. And I ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make us from those that He loves. We ask Allah for His love and the love of those who love Him and the love of the deed that draws us closer to His love. And I ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us from those who are granted Jannah al-Firdaws al-A'la without any previous punishment or any difficult account. Allahumma inna nas'aluka al-huda wa al-tuqa wa al-afafa wal-ghina. Allahumma ati nufusana taqwaha, zakkiha anta khairu min zakkaha, anta waliyuha wa mawlaha. Allahumma inna nas'aluka mujibat rahmatik wa azaa maghfiratik wal ghanimata min kulli bir was salamata min kulli إثم والفوز بالجنة والنجاة من النار. اللهم إنا نسألك عيش السعداء ونزول الشهداء والحشر مع الأتقياء ومرافقة الأنبياء، ونعوذ بك ربنا من جهد البلاء ودرك الشقاء وسوء القضاء وشماتة الأعداء. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من زوال نعمتك وفجاءة نقمتك وتحول عافيتك. اللهم اجعلنا من أهل القرآن الذين هم أهلك وخاصتك يا رحمن. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يقرأ القرآن فيرقى، ولا تجعلنا ممن يقرأ القرآن فيضل ويشقى. اللهم اجعل القرآن العظيم شفيعا لنا يوم القيامة. اللهم اجعل القرآن حجة لنا لا علينا. اللهم إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة، ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار. اللهم طهر قلوبنا من النفاق، وعمالنا من الرياء، وألسنتنا من الكذب، وعيوننا من الخيانة، فإنك تعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا، وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان، واجعلنا اللهم من الراشدين. اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا ورزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا. اللهم عنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك، يا مصرف القلوب صرف قلوبنا على طاعتك. اللهم إنا نسألك حسن الخاتمة، اللهم ارزقنا حسن الخاتمة، اللهم ارزقنا حسن الخاتمة يا رب العالمين. اللهم اغفر لوالدينا، اللهم ارحمهم كما ربونا صغارا، اللهم جازهم بالإحسان إحسانا وبالسيئات عفوا وغفرانا. اللهم من كان منهم حيا فاطر في عمره وأحسن في عمله، واختم لنا وله بخاتمة الإحسان. ومن كان منهم ميتا فأنزل على قبره شابب الرحمات، وافسح له في قبره مد بصره، واجعل قبره روضة من رياض الجنة، وجمعنا به في جناتك جنات النعيم. اللهم اجعلنا به من أهل البر والإحسان، ولا تجعلنا به من أهل العقوق والعصيان. اللهم اشف مريضهم، اللهم اشف مريضهم، اللهم اشف مريضهم، اللهم عاف مبتلاهم، اللهم عاف مبتلاهم، اللهم ارحم ميتهم، اللهم ارحم ميتهم، اللهم ارزق فقيرهم، اللهم اهد ضالهم، اللهم إنهم أحسنوا إلينا فأحسن إليهم، اللهم إنهم ألطفوا بنا فالطف بهم، اللهم إنهم رحمونا فارحمهم يا رب العالمين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين، واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. اللهم اجعلنا ممن دعاك فأجبته، واستهداك فهديته، واستنصرك فنصرته، واستغفرك فغفرت له. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد خير الأنام ومسك الختام، وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.